and see his foes lie crushed beneath his feet. For the conqueror has risen, and as the stone is rolled away and Christ emerges from the grave, this victory march continues till the day every eye and heart shall see. Strike, give grace for every hurdle as we
no way to generate anything in that power.
Yeah, because you need something to send and see. Good morning. I'm going to ask you to stand as we begin our service. Our call to worship is from Psalm 36. Your steadfast love, O Lord, extends to the heavens, your faithfulness to the clouds. Your righteousness is like the mountains of God. Your judgments are like the great deep. Man and beast you save, O Lord. How precious is your steadfast love, O God. The children of mankind take refuge in the shadow of your wings. They feast on the abundance of your house, and you give them drink from the river of your delights. For with you is the fountain of life. In your light do we see light. Let's pray. Our Father, we come in the name of Christ Jesus, our Savior, and we praise you for all your goodness. We praise you for the love that you have poured out on us through your Son. You that in you we find light. We ask for the power and the presence of your Spirit to be with us this morning. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen.
Oh, praise Him. His praises. One day when sin was as black as could be, Jesus came forth to be born of a virgin, dwelt among men.
My sins fall.
conceal him no longer. One day the stone rolled away from the door. Then he arose over death he had conquered. Now he's ascended, my Lord evermore.
Death could not hold him, the grave could not keep him from rising up. Living in love, me, dying, he saved me. Buried, he held me, my sins far away. Rising, he's justified, freely.
Let's pray. Our Heavenly Father, we thank you that because of Jesus, we can call you our Father. That you sent your Son to die for us, to remove the guilt of our sin, to provide us with the righteousness that we could not achieve on our own, to secure for us eternity with you. Father, you have adopted us as your children. You have poured out your love on us. And so we praise you that you are our good and kind and gracious Heavenly Father. And Lord, on this day, we thank you for our fathers. We thank you for the men of this church who have been examples of faithfulness to us. Men who have taught us your word and prayed for us. Men who have showed us what it looks like to be a man of God. We ask on this day that you would strengthen the fathers of our church, that you would continue to grow and equip them for all that you have called them to in life. Father, we thank you, though, that you are a good father, that you are our example to look to. Father, we also pray for the partners that we have today. We think of our friends at Sovereign Grace Church in Marlton. We thank you for Pastor Warren Betcher and the rest of the team there. We want to lift up their Children's Summer Blast camp that begins tomorrow. We ask that their church property would be filled with children from the community. We ask as the gospel is shared each day through word and song and games and crafts that you would speak in a strong way to the children that come, that you would save many, and this outreach would strengthen their connection in the Marlton area. I also pray for our friends in Belarus at the Gatava Church. We pray for our brother, Pastor Vladimir, as he continues to recover from illness. We ask that you would strengthen him. We ask that the time in rehab that he's going through now would build his body up, that he would return to his church soon, full of strength and energy and passion for you. We pray for Anatoly as he carries the load at this time, as he cares for the church, that you would strengthen him. And Father, we pray for the country of Belarus that is in so much turmoil right now. We ask for peace. We pray for protection for all of our friends and partners there, that you would surround them with your grace, that you would sustain them and encourage them in this time. Father, we also want to pray for all of our recent graduates from high school and college and beyond. We pray for their next steps in this coming year, that you would guide and direct them. We pray for our high school students that are going off to college. We ask that you would surround them with friends that love you. We ask that you'd help them to get quickly plugged into a church at school, and that you would use this season to grow their faith and trust in you. Father, we thank you for all these things. We thank you for how we see you at work in our church, in our lives, in our families. And we praise you. We pray in Jesus' name. Amen. Well, good morning and happy Father's Day to all the dads out here. We want to welcome you today. If you are visiting, you're a guest with us. We have a number up on the screen. If you are newer to our church, you can text your name to that number. That'll go right to one of the pastors, and we'll get back to you if there's questions that we can answer or just ways that we can be caring for you. We'll also be right up front here after the service. If you're newer or visiting, we'd love to meet you and say hi. Remember that you can give in various ways. You can give online. You can give using the drop box that's in the rear of the room, or you can give by text. A few announcements for you this morning. Want to highlight two upcoming conferences that featuring Nancy Guthrie. That'll be October 22nd and 23rd at the Sovereign Grace Church in Marlton. This conference is geared for helping women have just a greater sense of seeing God in His Word as they read. One of the lines from just the blurb that they have for the advertising is, "Do you sometimes wonder why some people have been able to draw things out of the a passage in the Bible that you didn't see until they pointed it out? If so, then this conference is for you. It'll increase your Bible skills so that God is communicating." So conference, October 22nd, 23rd. I believe registration for that opens July 1st. The second conference is called the Life Together Conference, The Gathered Church. This will be September 2nd to 4th at Covenant Fellowship Church in Glen Mills. This conference will focus on what the church should do when it gathers together. We know that we sing, that we listen to God's word, that we celebrate the gospel, and we enjoy God's presence with us. But this conference invites us as church members, as families, as ministry team leaders, as musicians, whoever you are, to take a fresh look at why we gather together and what should it look like. The goal is to make the time that we gather as a local church intentional, biblical, and fruitful. And so anyone is welcome to attend this conference. You can find more information and registration details on our website. And then finally, we are today celebrating all those that have graduated from high school and college and beyond. So you can see their names are on the screen. If that's you and you've recently graduated, if you could stand and we could celebrate you together. There on the offering drop box, there are sheets that list all of our graduates on them. Out, and you can be praying for all those that have graduated as they take next steps in their life. If there's any way that we can serve you, any needs that you have, please let us know.
Good morning. Just wanted to extend a special greeting and welcome to Elaine. Not quite sure where she went. I lost her. So glad that you're here with us this morning. I was just heard you were in town. I was just reminded of God's kindness to this church. Because of you and for the many years that you've just loved us and served us and just affected my life and so many others. So just thankful to God for you and glad that you're here this morning. Well, again, happy Father's Day to all the dads out there for your special day. I hope your day has been going well so far. My Father's Day started off with my three-year-old running out of bed and saying, "Dad, it's your Thanksgiving. You're the best dad ever." Then I got a card from my oldest that told me that I was a shooting rocket and a three-pointer. And then I had to encourage one of my children not to throw their Bible at their sibling. So, going as a typical day would go. I encourage you to open your Bibles to the Old Testament book of Zechariah. Go all the way to the end of the Old Testament, just before the New Testament, and flip a few pages back, and you'll find Zechariah. We're going to be in chapter 12. And we're going to be looking at verses 10 into chapter 13, verse 1 this morning. I'm not quite sure how your morning has gone so far as you've gathered yourself up and prepared and come into this room and what thoughts have been going through your mind and your heart, but we're going to take the next 35, 40 minutes to examine God's Word. And in this moment, the Lord God wants to address your heart. He wants to speak into your life. And so now as we turn to His Word, we must realize that God Himself is addressing us this morning. And so let's go with eyes open and ears ready and hearts soft to hear from the Lord. Zechariah 12, verse 10. And God says, "And I will pour out on the house of David and the inhabitants of Jerusalem a spirit of grace and pleas for mercy, so that when they look on me, on him whom they have pierced, they shall mourn for him as one mourns for an only child and weep bitterly over him as one weeps over a firstborn. On that day, the mourning in Jerusalem will be as great as the mourning for Hadad Rimmon in the plain of Megiddo. The land shall mourn, each family by itself, the family of the house of David by itself, and their wives by themselves, the family of the house of Nathan by itself, and their wives by themselves, the family of the house of Levi by itself, and their wives by themselves, the family of the Shemites by itself, and their wives by themselves, that are left, each by itself, and their wives by themselves. And on that day, there shall be a fountain open for the house of David and the inhabitants of Jerusalem to cleanse them from their sin and uncleanness. May God bless the reading and the preaching of His word. This morning, we come to this point in this prophetic book, and we must see what God is doing. God is after the hearts of His people. At this point in the prophetic ministry of Zechariah, these people, they have experienced the kindness of God. God, by His sovereign initiative, has brought them back out of exile, bringing the people back to the city of Jerusalem, the blessed city. He is establishing the community, rebuilt the city walls, rebuilt the center of worship, the temple. God has given His people abundant encouragement through the words of His prophet. The people have heard promises from God that He would bless them, that He would prosper. Promises to His people that He desires to dwell with them and that He will be the one to protect them and give them victory over their enemies. Throughout this book, God has shown His kindness to His people, and in the midst of His displays of kindness, there is this ongoing call for the people to give themselves wholeheartedly to the Lord. This call, this invitation by God to turn away from their foolishness, to turn away from their self-centeredness, to give their hearts to Him alone. The very beginning of this book, chapter 1, verse 3, Zechariah says, "Therefore say to them," to the people, "thus declares the Lord of hosts, return to me, says the Lord of hosts, and I will return to you." God blesses these people again and again and prospers them and protects them and encourages them, all the while saying, "Return to me." You see, God's not after cities or walls or earthly prosperity or even temple buildings. God is after the hearts of His people. See, God knows something that is required of men if they are to give their hearts to Him fully. He knows that something must take place for men and women to give their hearts over fully to Him. And so through the mouth of His prophet, God gives words to His people of what will one day take place. There will be a day of mourning, a day of weeping, of bitter sorrow that will come as a result of God pouring out grace and pleas for mercy. There will be a day when the movement of God will capture the hearts of His people through mourning. This text is meant to bring God's people to pause and to ponder. and to consider what this morning is, a morning that is required for the hearts of men to be fully given over to God. So our question this morning, what is this morning? What kind of sorrow leads men to give their heart fully to God? It's a question for you to ask yourself. What kind of sorrow must I know to give my heart fully to God? Our main point this morning. The heart that is fully given to God is a heart that will look on Him with sorrow and find grace. Let's set ourselves in the context of the words of the prophet. God has been doing a work among His people. He's sovereignly orchestrating their experience of history. Throughout all of it, God is always revealing. Do you know that that's what history is? That's what history is all about. It's God revealing Himself through the events that people experience. History is His story, declaring who He is and then giving us an interpretation for understanding all of it. Means to reveal Himself to His people. So the people in Zechariah's day, they have been experiencing a history. God has been revealing His nature and His character and His will to this people. The most recent events that these people would know all too well is their exile from God's blessed city. Their separation from Him as a result of their sin, of their rebellion, of their self-centered desires for life. And God sent them away to know the consequences of their sin. These people were sent away to understand that God was displeased in a foreign nation. And then these people experience God's favor. Through the prophets, God is calling them not just to turn away from captivity and return to a place, but to turn away from their rebellion and to return to their God. He's calling His people to repent. That's the meaning of the words of the prophet to this people. It is a call for repentance. It's a call for us this morning to consider what that means in our own hearts, in our own lives. Our task is to examine the question before us, what is true repentance? What does it mean to truly return to God? What does true repentance look like? And what we find in these verses is that true repentance involves genuine sorrow over our sin. True repentance involves genuine sorrow over our sin. That's a bit of the what's happening in this context. And I think it's important for us also to grasp the time that this is taking place and what is the perspective of the when of these events. Remember when my family, when we were in Kentucky at the Sovereign Grace Pastors College, and we had opportunity throughout the year to come back here and to visit family and to be a part of our home church and to be blessed by that. And we would drive east through Kentucky and into West Virginia on our trip back. And I remember driving on those flat highway in Kentucky and approaching the mountains in West Virginia. And from a distance, you can just see these beautiful mountains off on the horizon. And you would look at them and I'd say, oh wow, look at that mountain right next to that one. As though the mountains were side by side. And then once you get closer and you get in the mountains, you realize these mountains aren't next to each other at all. They're separated by quite a distance. What we have here from the prophet Zechariah is what some scholars call the prophetic perspective or the prophetic horizon. It's as though Zechariah is on the highway in Kentucky and sees these mountains far off, and he speaks of them as though they're side by side. The coming of Christ in the incarnation, in his life on this earth, and the return of Christ at his second coming in the consummation of all things. And Zechariah sees them, and when he talks of those events out there, he speaks of them as though they're side by side. For us this morning, we're in the mountains. We've gone past that first mountain. So when Zechariah says things like, on that day, he's speaking of not a 24-hour period, but an age that is out before him. And it's an age that we experience today, the age of the New Testament church, those who can look back at the events of Jesus' life and his death and his resurrection and yet still look forward to when he will return, when we sing, oh, what a glorious day. So the words we have from Zechariah's perspective are words that we can look both ways and observe and see and experience and know the effects of these things. We're in the age of the last days, of when these things are taking place. We are living in those days. And so when we read these words, we must consider how the prophet says that God pours out on his people a spirit of grace and pleas for mercy, so that when they look on me, on him whom they have pierced, they will mourn. For us to truly understand what this mourning is and what true repentance looks like, we must first look at the cause of this mourning. He says, when they look on him whom they have pierced. Sin is the cause of this piercing. What is sin? Sin can simply be stated, it's rebellion. It's defiance. It's violence against the one who made us. We have recorded for us in the beginning of our Bibles the events that have affected all of us. Adam and Eve in the garden, living in harmony, in relationship, under the authority of God who formed them and made them, and desires to be with them and to bless them and to walk alongside them under his authority. Why? Because he made them. And we see the sad tale of rebellion entering into the hearts of men. You shall not eat from this tree, and yet they believe a lie, go against their maker, and they rebel. They defy. They do violence against the authority of the God who made them and loves them. And as a result of that sin, it has trickled down to the hearts of everyone. And so the Bible speaks not only of how that sin has come into the world, but how that sin now infects all of creation and all the hearts of men. Paul says it this way in Romans 5, therefore, just as sin came into the world through one man, and death through sin, and so death spread to all men, because all have sinned. What's the promise of God when he gives them the command not to eat of the tree? Or you will surely die. You will surely experience separation, brokenness in this relationship that you are meant to have with your God. Sin separates. Sin is in the hearts of us all. And sin separates. The nature of death is the result of sin, because it's an attack on the nature and character of God, on his sovereignty and on his goodness. It damages the relationship that men and women were to have with the one who made them. And so all sin is this violent act of rebellion against the God who made us. And the Bible will not let up on its pressure on the individual responsibility of all men when it comes to sin. Every one of us, everyone in Zechariah's day, is responsible for their rebellion against God. Every one of us are to read these words, "On him whom they have pierced," and we are to put an I in that sentence. On him who I have pierced. Sin is a piercing of God himself. And we are all responsible. Notice the language in verse 10, where God is speaking and he says, "A spirit of grace and pleas for mercy, so that when they look on me, on him who they have pierced." We get an Old Testament taste of the Trinity, of the Godhead. God himself speaks of being the one looked upon and the one pierced, and also speaks of him who will be pierced. All sin, all of my sin, all of your sin is responsible for the piercing of God. You might be familiar with the old spiritual, "Were you there when they crucified my Lord? Were you there? Were you there?" If we understand the words of Scripture rightly, we must answer, "I was there. I was there." Not as a spectator sitting off in the distance on a hill. No. There as an eager participant. I was a voice in the crowd crying out, "Crucify him." I was one standing on the road as he carried the cross out of the city to the hill called Golgotha, mocking and laughing and spitting. I had a hand on the hammer that drove the nails through his hands and his feet. When I look and I see that spear that was thrust into the side of the Savior, and I look at the hands that are holding that spear, I must see that they are my own. I was there. And even the thought of that, we may be tempted to think, no, not me. Not that way, not my Jesus. But until we see our own sin as culpable in the crucifying death of Jesus, we will not know what true repentance is. We will not understand what this mourning is that the prophet speaks of. We will not know the real depth of forgiveness, and we will not experience the transforming work of the Spirit. In the first recorded Christian sermon in the book of Acts, when Peter preaches on the day of Pentecost, in Acts 2:36, he says this, "Let all the house of Israel therefore know for certain that God has made him both Lord and Christ, this Jesus whom you crucified." And what happens to the hearers of those words? The Bible says they are cut to the heart. They know. Are cut by it, and they ask, what should we do? That's what we must know for ourselves this morning. The first part of true repentance is to see ourselves responsible in our own sin. So when we look on Him, experience would bring for a parent to go through the heartache of having their only child. What mourning would take place? They speak of, in verse 11, that day the mourning in Jerusalem will be as great as the mourning for Hadad-Rimmon in the plain of Megiddo. And I read those words and you go, oh yeah, I know exactly what that means. Your pastors have commentaries. This verse is getting at an experience that the nation of Israel had when King Josiah was killed in battle. King Josiah was the last godly king in Judah. He became king at the age of 8, and he gave his heart fully to God, and he restored worship to the nation, and he cast out the idols, and he was a valiant lover of the Lord, and he led the nation to return their hearts to God. He was this last great light and hope for the nation, and he was killed in battle, and the nation wept bitterly over this loss. There was never a righteous king on the throne again for the nation of Judah. I find it interesting that what we have here to illustrate this mourning is two examples of death and loss. It highlights for us what sin does. When we capture the reality of sin, we know that all of it is this mourning of loss. Because sin seeks to kill relationship with a good and loving God. It seeks to sever our fellowship with Him. That's what all sin seeks to do. And so, if we are people that want our hearts fully to God, then we will see all sin as this death blow and this loss to our relationship with God, and we will weep bitterly because of it. Verses 12 to 14, they give us an illustration of how this mourning will take place when this Spirit of grace and mercy is poured out. We have there a list of names, David and Nathan, Levi and the Shemites, and they're all mourning, each family by itself and the wives by themselves. It's getting at this repetition to show that there is this comprehensive experience of mourning over sin. That each individual heart, it will not be this mourning that can be represented by a few leaders or this mourning that will just take place as a nation, but it will be mourning that will enter into the hearts of every man and woman. From David, who is the highest of the royal line, to his descendant Nathan, a lower on the royal line. From Levi, who is the first and highest of the priestly line, down to Shimei, who is a descendant of that line. All people will experience this mourning in their own hearts. When they look on him. But we must ask this morning about the genuine nature of this mourning. What kind of weeping, of sorrow for sin is truly genuine? How do we know if it's an authentic sorrow that we have on our sin? Because God, he's after our hearts. He's after the hearts of his people. He is not pleased with outward displays. He wants the authenticity of a heart that is truly given over to him. The Apostle Paul gives us some helpful understanding of this reality. In 2 Corinthians chapter 7, he says this, that there are two kinds of sorrow, of grief. He says, for godly grief, that produces a repentance that leads to salvation without regret, whereas worldly grief produces death. And so, hang in with me for these next few moments and ask yourselves these questions. Has my experience any of grief over sin been a godly sorrow or a worldly sorrow? We have to know the answer because one leads to life and the other leads to death. What does worldly sorrow look like? Worldly sorrow is an experience of sadness over our sin, but it's a sadness that's short-lived. We might be saddened when we experience sin in our lives, when we see it flow out of our own hearts, but it's a sadness that has a brief amount of time and effect in our lives. It does not lead us to lasting change. It does not take root in such a way that we want the sorrow to remain so the sin will not. Worldly sorrow is brief and fleeting. Worldly sorrow will count the cost of keeping sin in our lives. How much will it cost me to let go of this sin? And is it really worth it? I mean, can I just hold, I understand that this sin is wrong, but can I just keep it a little bit? Can I measure the level that it has in my life and so it won't do too much damage? I don't see how this particular sin is really hurting anybody else, so I don't know if it really matters that I have to rid it from my life. It doesn't seem to be that issue at this point in my life, but if it does progress, then I'll deal with it later. That's worldly sorrow. Worldly sorrow hates the consequences of sin. It's a sorrow that we might experience because of our sin that's only centered on the consequences as a result of that sin. We're sorry because of what kind of damage the sin caused. We're sorry because this sin is now getting in the way of my agenda, of my goals. It it messed up this relationship a little bit. It took away some of my freedoms. It made me feel a little uncomfortable. And I don't like those feelings. So I'm sorry about that sin. You see, worldly sorrow, it cares mostly about the breaking of my own life. See, I have this picture in my mind, in my heart, of what I want my life to be, of how I want things to go. And I will be saddened by sin and its effects as much as it disturbs and hinders the picture of my life, of my agenda. Worldly sorrow is centered on self. But godly sorrow is wholly different. A godly sorrow, it is not fleeting and short-lived. It has lasting effect on our hearts. It's a sorrow that is deeply rooted into our hearts so that it leads to change in our lives. Godly sorrow, it does not count the cost of sin. Will this sin be worth getting rid of? No. Godly sorrow will pursue whatever it takes to be free of that sin. There is no measure of sin that could be worth hanging on to when we have godly sorrow. There's no waiting on it. No. Godly sorrow wants sin to be eradicated fully and immediately, because it knows what that sin is doing in my relationship with my God. Godly sorrow does not hate the consequences of sin only, yet it might, because they are real and they are hard. But godly sorrow hates the sin itself. It's appropriate to be saddened by the effects of sin. Sin does damage. Breaks circumstances. It does damage to our own hearts and our own minds, and we mourn that damage. But a godly sorrow weeps over sin itself because it knows that that sin has offended my God. And that matters above all else. Godly sorrow is not primarily concerned with the breaking of my life, but of the breaking of God's heart. We weep over sin because all of our sin pierces the heart of God. The Bible gives us a picture of what this godly sorrow could look like. In Psalm 51, David is grieved over his sin. He has godly grief, and out of that, his heart says things like this: "For I know my transgressions, and my sin is ever before me. Against you, you only have I sinned and done what is evil in your sight, so that you may be justified in your words and blameless in your judgment. Behold, you delight in truth in the inward being. You teach me wisdom in the secret heart. You will not delight in sacrifice, or I would give it. You will not be pleased with a burnt offering. The sacrifices of God are a broken spirit, a broken and contrite heart, O God, you will not despise." People of God, we must see that true repentance, truly giving our hearts to God, it must involve a mourning over our sin, a godly weeping, because our sin pierces the heart of God. Worldly sorrow brings tears that flow from the well of what we want, and godly sorrow brings tears that flow from the well of what God wants. This This revelation of this text, I have to confess, it has worked me over in my study. It has worked over my heart because as I've thought and prayed over this, I've come to realize that so much of my sadness over my own sin, of my confessing to God, of my prayers, so much of it could be labeled as just worldly sorrow. So much of what I have experienced because of my own sin is really just because it messed up my life. And I've just had to come before God and just confess those things and beg Him that He would open my eyes and soften my heart to see that the littlest, what I would think the littlest bit of sin is, pierces His heart. It breaks His heart. And to grant to me, to pour out on me a spirit that would let me truly weep bitterly over my sin. I want to know what it is to truly grieve my sin the way that it hurts His heart. Because only through that, will I really taste the depths and experience the grace of His forgiveness. I must know what my sin does, because Paul says that godly sorrow produces repentance that leads to salvation. I want to go there and not the other way. This is the call for us this morning to truly know that God's Spirit would move in our hearts and our minds, that we would never take our sin lightly, but that we might see it and feel it the way God does and mourn as a result. And this morning, we're told in verse 10, it comes as a result of this outpouring of a spirit of grace and pleas for mercy. That we would be filled by God's Spirit to see our sin rightly and bring us to a place where we cry out, God, have mercy on me, a sinner, before You. We must see our sin rightly. We must weep with godly grief. And we must mourn over the grace that meets us. When we look on Him, the one who was pierced, and see the grace there will well up in us tears of wonder and amazement. Because this one who was pierced did it because He loves you, did it to save you, did it to redeem you, experienced it that you would be His. When we look on Him who was pierced, we weep over the depth and the damage of our sin, and we should shed tears over amazing grace. We should look on Him and see our responsibility in sin and His response of great grace for the sinner. In John 19, that day He says, since it was the day of preparation, so that the bodies of those hanging would not remain on the cross on the Sabbath, the Jews asked Pilate that their legs might be broken and that they might be taken away. So the soldiers came and broke the legs of the first and of the other who had been crucified with Jesus. But when they came to Jesus, They saw that he was already dead. They did not break his legs. But one of the soldiers pierced his side with a spear. And at once there came out blood and water. He who saw it has borne witness. His testimony is true, and he knows that he is telling the truth, that you also may believe. For these things took place that the scripture might be fulfilled. Not one of his bones will be broken. And again, the other scripture, they will look on him whom they have pierced. The divine response to our sin should cause us to weep tears of wonder, amazement at his grace. When we look on him, we should see this divine love that meets our pleas of mercy. When we look on the one who was pierced and hanging on the cross, I do not believe that he hung there with his eyes closed, shut off from the witnesses. No, I think his eyes were open, and he was gazing back at those who caused him to be hanging there with eyes filled with compassion and grace and words that say, "Forgive them, they know not what they do." Friends, look on him. Look on him who was pierced for you, to forgive you. He did not deserve it. Every one of us did. Isaiah the prophet says that he was pierced for our transgressions. He was crushed for our iniquities. Upon him was the chastisement that brought us peace. By his wounds, we're healed. That is amazing grace that should cause us to cry in wonder. He was pierced. Chapter 13, verse 1 of our text says that because he was pierced, a fountain has been opened. A fountain for the people of God to cleanse them from their sin. Friends, we should weep bitter tears over our sin, but not without hope. not without hope, because as his side was pierced and blood and water flowed out, blood to pay for our transgressions and water to cleanse the sinner from their sin. That's amazing. We weep with great hope. And a fountain on that day, on that hill, some 2,000 years ago, has been open. And I tell you this morning, if you have entered this room and you don't know the depth and weight of your own sin, then you don't know the mercy and grace that is there. I tell you, come under this fountain. It is open for you. No longer hold on to your sin and think it's okay, it's not that bad. It is, but there's forgiveness. A fountain has been open for you, and everyone needs this fountain. And what does this fountain do? It cleanses us and changes us. God is after the hearts of his people to change us. I don't care if you're 9 or 90, God means to change you. He's not done with you. And so, believer, This fountain is open every day. Every day for you to truly mourn your sin, wonder at His grace, come under His fountain when you look on Him. Let's pray. Our gracious, loving God, You take sin seriously and holy. So this morning, for every one of us, Father, do not let us leave. Do not let us go through this day without causing us to pause and ponder. If necessary, may Your Spirit work in our hearts that we would go and weep bitterly, and that we would come under the fountain of cleansing and forgiveness. O Spirit, do Your work in the hearts of this people. In Christ's name, in the One who was pierced, we pray. Amen.
My friends, let's stand and sing in response. There is a fountain.
is not a light word. But I believe that the Apostle Paul gives about godly grief that leads to salvation. He then says, without regret. And I can honestly stand before you this morning and I can say, never in my life have I taken a step of obedience or a step of repentance that I've regretted. Not one. Many other things I have, but never one small step in giving my heart to God have I regretted. Because there you find life and joy in abundance. So this morning, we're going to dismiss, but God's not done at work in this room. So don't leave without making that step. If you feel God's Spirit pressing it on your heart, I promise you won't regret it. Talk to a friend. Come up to one of the pastors. We'd love to pray with you, to talk with you, and God will bless it. Let me close with these words. The end of Paul's letter to the Corinthians, he says this: may the grace of the Lord Jesus Christ and the love of God and the fellowship of the Holy Spirit be with you all. Amen. Amen. Thank you for coming this morning.